Inner Traditions Audio presents Your Symphony of Selves. Discover and understand more of who we are. By James Fadiman, PhD, and Jordan Gruber, JD. Read by Andy Rick. Note to the listener. Not so radical after all. For many years, I worked on understanding why healthy selves seem to be such a radical idea, when on so many levels it felt completely obvious. Only after we began our scholarship on the history of psychology did we come to recognize something very important. In early psychology, the only real issue was between two groups, one composed of scientists and philosophers who felt that every human being had selves, and another set of important clinicians, working to develop the first theories of mental illness, who felt that different selves appeared only in their patient populations. Then there was a fundamental sea change in the early 1900s, after which it was not okay to discuss selves at all. This sea change was so thorough and unchallengeable that for all practical purposes, there has been no more discussion of healthy selves in psychology or psychiatry since then. Though from time to time, less healthy selves were theorized about and entered into common conversation. Instead of seeing ourselves as proponents of a radical view of human nature, what we realized is that we were simply continuing to explore and illuminate the way that people had been thinking prior to the general suppression of the idea. We described the reasons for that suppression and its remarkable success. When we discovered we weren't trailblazers, the project became a little less exciting, but it was also an enormous relief to realize that we were simply rediscovering a fully developed tradition and presenting it in contemporary terms. Selves have always been here, even in psychology, so we might as well learn to work with them. James Fadiman. From Lewis Carroll, Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. The caterpillar and Alice looked at each other for some time in silence. At last, the caterpillar took the hookah out of its mouth and addressed her in a languid, sleepy voice. "Who are you?" said the caterpillar. This was not an encouraging opening for a conversation. Alice replied, rather shyly, I hardly know, sir. Just at present. At least, I know who I was when I got up this morning. But I think I must have been changed several times since then." "What do you mean by that?" said the caterpillar sternly. "Explain yourself." "I can't explain myself, I'm afraid, sir," said Alice. "Because I'm not myself, you see." Section 1. Welcome from all of us to all of you. Chapter 1. What this is about and what we hope to accomplish. All human beings, including those who are healthiest and most successful, are composed of more than one self. When things are going well, each plays its rightful role as part of a harmonious symphony. We really are different people, or have different minds, parts, or personalities, in different moments and in different contexts. This is not a new observation. It goes back thousands of years, and it is not difficult to understand, at least not in its basic form. Instead, it is extremely useful and beneficial. By appreciating what is actually so about ourselves and others, many things in our lives begin to make more sense. Please consider the following questions. Have you ever argued with yourself? With whom were you arguing? Who was the other voice or other voices? If you have ever argued with yourself and changed sides, who did that? When looking at that last cookie or piece of cake or candy, who says yes and who says no? Have you ever been by yourself or with your old friends and done something truly wild and crazy? Something you would never do around your parents, children, coworkers, or boss? Who was it that acted that way? Was that same part of you embarrassed later on? Have you ever gotten so inebriated that you said or did things that you would normally never do, or caused physical or psychological damage to yourself or someone else? Who did that? Who got the hangover? And who eventually felt the shame or regret? Have you ever been so stressed that you did something you told yourself you would never do? Once you did it, or perhaps even while you were doing it, did another part of you already know you were making a big mistake? Would that part of you show up again if you experienced the same sort of stress? Acknowledging these different parts of ourselves is what this book is all about. To say, for example, that people merely have different moods at different times misses our main thrust. The selves that compose us are actual, real, independent, and innately valuable parts of who we are. In addition to addressing questions like these, we will offer many examples from ordinary, day-to-day life, some of which will likely remind you of similar experiences in your own life. We will also make frequent reference to popular culture, books, movies, music, and cartoons. Finally, we will discuss the thoughts of a wide range of thinkers, writers, scientists, and artists who have grappled with this issue throughout history. The collected and synthesized information we are providing here might at first puzzle you or disturb your equilibrium, or even upend your theory of yourself and others. But it will likely change, for the better, how you view and understand yourself, yourselves, and others, their selves. As you listen, we are hopeful you will do at least two things. Begin to let go of the ways you tend to characterize who you are as a single, unitary, monolithic self, and begin to accept and appreciate your own selves and the selves of others. These things, relatively easy to do, often provide immediate benefits, as will be described. Most of our ideas are easy to understand and may feel very familiar to you. They seem to make sense to most people once, based on their own life experiences, they bring them to awareness. For many, the prospect of living a better life, consciously noticing and working with what we are describing, proves an enticing possibility. How the single self assumption limits optimal human functioning. The difficult part, the problem we all face, is that this way of looking at things is so rarely discussed that most people simply are not aware of it. A veil seems to exist that prevents us from directly experiencing or considering the idea that we are, or can be, a collection of harmonious, healthy selves. Going forward, we will refer to the healthy selves, or healthy normal selves, idea, worldview, or perspective. This barrier or veil follows directly from the unexamined pervasiveness of what we call the single self assumption, which, in its simplest form, is the idea that each of us is a single, unified self. As a result of the pervasiveness of the single self assumption, the reality of experiencing ourselves as a healthy multiplicity is seldom considered. If it is brought up, it may be laughed away or simply dismissed. But when we become aware of, question, and step beyond the single self assumption, our worldview shifts. This alternative posits that greater health, functioning, and satisfaction come to people who understand and make practical good use of the recognition that selves are real. The new assumption is that it is normal to have more than one self. Perhaps more importantly, optimal functioning and well-being necessitates acknowledging and working with all of ourselves. Those who do this demonstrate increasing congruence among their words, behavior, and plans. They are seen by others as being coherent in their interactions and communications. They are also kinder and more compassionate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.